Hi, I'm Dr. Matt Najad, and in this video, I'm going to be talking about the tooth cycle of death, which describes a process or cycle that occurs very commonly in restorative dentistry. And it's basically a series of different interventions and failures that culminates in loss of teeth. And we're going to be reviewing this so that we can understand how changing the approach can minimize this and help us preserve and keep teeth for life. So, the tooth cycle of death, of course, begins with a natural intact tooth. And it's very important to understand and appreciate how the natural intact tooth really has optimal structure and properties, which gives it the best chance of succeeding long-term and minimizing complications and leading to failures. We have enamel, which forms a very stiff, strong, rigid outer shell of the tooth. Then you have dentin, which is the dampening inner core, like the shock absorber of the tooth, which receives stresses and transmits them through the root of the tooth, or the roots of the teeth. The important thing is that enamel and dentin have pretty significantly different properties, one being significantly stiffer than the other. And if these two materials are not joined together strongly, there'll be a lot of failures and cracks and fractures, but the dentin enamel junction forms a strong biological bond that brings these two different materials together in a way that allows stresses to flow fluidly through. And that's very important because as a structure, the tooth is only successful because of the combination of these properties. If the tooth was made entirely out of enamel, then it would be too stiff and it would fracture and crack and fail all the time. And if it was made entirely of dentin, then it wouldn't be wear resistant enough and it would also have problems and failures long term. It's the combination of the properties that makes the tooth so successful. And keep that in mind because that means when we restore the tooth, we want to be able to mimic and restore these properties as well. So, once you have an initial cavity, then you need to restore the tooth. Now, while the tooth is extremely strong in its ability to withstand mechanical pressure and loads, it's still susceptible to failure from cavities. And cavities form from acid dissolution of the enamel. The enamel is susceptible to an acidic caries process, especially when the conditions are not favorable, when there's poor plaque control, when there isn't adequate hygiene, and so on. So once a cavity forms, an initial filling must be placed. And traditionally, the filling was an amalgam filling or a silver filling. And this type of filling requires significant additional removal of tooth structure. So you've gone from this small cavity and now you've reduced significantly more of the tooth because the restorative technique calls for that. Because it needs extension for prevention to get a good marginal seal. It requires a minimum amount of reduction so that the material is not too thin so it won't fracture and break. And it also requires additional tooth structure removal to retain the restoration, which means to keep the restoration in place, you need to remove extra tooth structure. Well, because it's a non-bonded filling and because you've removed so much additional tooth, what happens over time is cracks develop. The filling, the silver filling, does restore the cavity, but it doesn't regain the strength and the properties that an intact natural tooth does. So now the biomechanics are altered, which means every time you are chewing on the tooth or every time the patient is using the tooth, there's gonna be stress concentrations in unnatural areas, especially around the silver fillings, around the marginal ridges. And what happens is this leads to cracks. Sometimes these cracks lead to symptoms, sometimes they go unnoticed, but eventually these turn into fractures. Cusp fractures around silver fillings are very common. So traditional restorations, which start with silver fillings, typically carry on for many years and eventually lead to fractures known as cusp fractures, sometimes with pain, sometimes without pain. At this point, the tooth must be restored, and since there's significant tooth structure already missing, it becomes very common now to attempt to restore the tooth with a crown, because now it becomes important to not only restore the fractured cusp, replace the existing filling that was there, but also now it becomes important to try to address the strength that was not restored in the first treatment. So now you'd place a crown. However, unfortunately, this requires, again, more removal of intact tooth structure. Typically, a crown removes up to 75% of coronal tooth structure. So you've removed 75% of the tooth structure that is present above the alveolar bone. And at this point, this is meaning that the tooth is very likely to have additional failures. Crowns do have significant complications long-term, significantly higher chance of complications, leading to root canals for a variety of reasons, including poor marginal seal, sensitivity, the cumulative loss of tooth structure contributes to this. For one reason or another, a root canal treatment typically will occur with a higher chance on a crown tooth versus a intact tooth or a unrestored tooth. So you do the root canal and now you take a look at how much tooth structure is remaining here and you see that there isn't much room left for mechanical retention. So the crown relied on mechanical retention, the silver filling relied on mechanical retention, which means having enough tooth structure to hold the restoration in place. But by this point, you don't have much tooth structure left because you've removed more and more throughout the process. So now the most common solution is to place a post and core. A post and core serve only one purpose. The purpose of a post and a core is to retain the crown. So you're placing a post and a core so that the crown has something to again hold on to. And now you have your crown restoration. You have very little remaining coronal tooth structure, but you have a crown restoration. However, as this crown is used, stresses again transmit through the tooth in a very unnatural way. The biomechanics of a tooth restored with a post and core are nothing like an intact tooth. Stresses concentrate around the post in the root, and this is not what happens in a normal intact tooth. And what happens is the chance of a unrestorable or catastrophic failure is high. And that means, for example, having a vertical root fracture, something that's not treatable or restorable. And when that happens, you're unable to restore the tooth. Therefore, you have to look at replacement options, including an implant as the most ideal solution. Other options for replacing a tooth that's been lost are a bridge, but that involves damage to the adjacent teeth and compromising those. You can also have a removable partial denture, or you cannot restore the tooth at all. But all these occur because as you've done the restorative treatments over time, you haven't respected that the importance of the tooth goes beyond filling the cavity or placing the crown. It also involves restoring the strength and the biomechanics of the tooth and the rigidity. And these things have been studied and understood, and bonded restorations are able to help us restore teeth more faithfully. Amalgam silver fillings are not bonded and they don't do that. Sometimes a composite filling still behaves as a non-bonded restoration if it has a poor bond or it's not restoring the properties of the tooth because it's very large, it has a low modulus of elasticity. There's a variety of reasons that translate to the tooth having an altered biomechanics. And when that happens, you will expect that the tooth will experience higher chance of complications and failures, and it will have a higher chance of ultimately being lost. So in biomimetic dentistry, the goal is to interrupt this cycle, to prevent the series of steps that result in losing teeth. So from the very first time the tooth is treated with a cavity, if a conservative composite restoration is placed, that doesn't involve removing additional tooth structure, then you can have more of the tooth stay intact, more of the strength of the tooth maintained, and because it's a bonded restoration, it can regain some of the stiffness that's been lost from the cavity or even the preparation. So first time you intervene with a biomimetic restoration, it becomes very important to try to make that restoration last as long as possible. As you proceed through treatments, avoiding full coverage crowns with partial inlays or onlays also has a dramatic role in minimizing the incidence of root canals and subsequent post and core. And using an adhesive approach is one of the key methods to prevent the tooth cycle of death. So biomimetic dentistry prevents the tooth cycle of death in a variety of ways. In biomimetic dentistry, there are three major pillars that we appreciate and respect and apply to every restoration. One is to mimic the properties and structure of natural teeth. Two is to preserve tooth structure and pulp vitality. And then three is to restore the strength, stiffness, and structural integrity of the intact natural tooth. When you apply biomimetic dentistry and you aim to mimic the tooth and preserve intact tooth structure and regain the strength and stiffness of a natural intact tooth, you dramatically minimize the occurrence of these complications. The tooth cycle of death can be prevented in a large majority of cases, and that's good for patients, it's good for dentists, and that's why biomimetic dentistry has a huge advantage. And it's also why biomimetic dentistry is the most logical choice for all restorative dentistry.